Thank you very much for having me today. I was thinking about what I could share, and then I revisited my red notebook here filled with notes from the first time I had a chance to listen to John's lecture just a few months after moving to Shanghai last year. So congratulations to John on the book, or should I say Luo Siyi, which is what you're known here in China as. And thank you for your work in general, because it's been fundamental for many of us in helping us understand China from a Marxist economic perspective. And primarily that China is in fact a socialist country in the process of socialist construction and hasn't ceased to be in its 72-year process now. And nowhere can we see that more clearly than in the process of the struggle against poverty. And for purely selfish reasons, I know that we at Tricontinental have been really glad that this book got published right in this moment, because in just under 2 weeks, we're about to launch a study on the poverty alleviation process called Serve the People, China's Eradication of Extreme Poverty. And of course, in it, we were able to kind of use the work that John has done to help us in the process. And I wanted to share a little bit about that process and how John's work in this book has helped us. Not only has John been a very generous advisor on the project, but the book itself has been very, very informative in that process. We've already talked about it in the event so far, and that, you know, when we're talking about poverty alleviation, one of the big numbers that comes up is this 853 million people, 76% of global reduction since the opening reform period. And John's book really helps us understand that this is not a departure from socialism, but a continuation based on, as Kenny was saying, this, we are understanding that China was and continues to be in the primary stage of socialism. And the fundamental question of that period was how to develop the productive forces quickly, integrate into the world economy, reintroduce, which required a reintroduction of private capital, but not in the dominant sense. I mean, till today we see, I mean, we're seeing very recently how much the government is reeling in the excesses of capital, taking on big tech in a real way. It is a continuation of the fact that yes, a capitalist class does exist in China, but capitalism as a process is not what is dominant. And political power has actually never been transferred to the hands of capitalists. And in that process, of course, the, you know, economic floor was lifted for the vast majority of Chinese people at an impressive speed. And what John's book does is it helps us understand that this massive economic growth of the post-reform period is not apart from, but thanks to the social and economic gains of the pre-reform period, and that is under Mao. And we've already, many of the comrades here have already talked about statistic in economic terms that John often cites in terms of understanding where the situation was for China in the founding of the PRC. In GDP per capita terms, China was the 11th poorest country. I mean, that's a very evocative reminder of the impact of imperialism, what this, you know, century of imperialism meant for China. How could a country that used to be 25% of the global economy at the, you know, early 19th century fall to just 5% around the time of 1949. And of course, losing 30 million lives just in the Second World War, not you know, accounting for all the numbers of people that, you know, died as other impacts of imperialism. So the social gains that of this period, we can't understand this poverty alleviation without understanding social gains of that period. You know, we've already mentioned healthcare, education, literacy, adding a year or more than a year of lifespan to average person's life for every year of the revolution. I mean, these are incredible kinds of numbers to think about. And technologically, and from a side of productive capacity, it's important to remember that in 1949, China couldn't even domestically produce a car. And by 1970, they sent a satellite up to space. And as a fun fact, you know, the satellite called Dongfanghong, which many people know, East is Red. But lesser known is that the East is Red actually sent, that played the song, the same revolutionary song name, while it was orbiting in space during its 28 days out in the outer space. So I think that's just brilliant little fun fact. So when Xi comes to power in 2013, you know, we see this, you know, he says that he spent more time on poverty alleviation than anything else. And I believe it. you know, it continues on this multi-decade process. And that is the core of the focus of our study, is looking at the targeted poverty alleviation period, because China is actually a really dynamic place. It learns, it tests, it innovates, it makes mistakes, corrects, as good Marxists do. And so this targeted phase is a accumulation of this decades long process. And I think there's three things I want to just point out of what made this a very specific and interesting thing for us, especially those of the South, to learn from. The first is that it was multidimensional in character. Not only income, we've already talked about, you know, World Bank standards, it was higher than World Bank. That is the income side, but it wasn't an income distribution project. It was based on, you know, two other key factors, which is the, what is called the two assurances. You don't have to worry about food and clothing. And also the three guarantees: housing with clean water, running water, electricity, basic healthcare, and then education, that here in China is 9 years free and compulsory. The second factor is the mobilization of the whole society, obviously under the leadership of the party, but this includes the state-owned enterprises, the private sector, civil society. You know, you have huge amounts of mobilization, making sure that the Eastern, richer, but more developed places are partnered with the lesser developed Western ones. You have massive training and dispatching of medical professionals, reminding us of the barefoot doctor days, teachers, experts, students to the countryside for years at a time. And I think number three, and probably the most important aspect, is aspect of party building, or rebuilding a party organization at the grassroots level. I mean, the numbers just came out after last week's centenary, and it was amazing to be here in China for that. The party is 95.1 million members. So if the party was a country, it'd be the 16th most populous country in the world. It is a massive organization. But in this process of the poverty alleviation, what was key is sending 3 million cadre down to the countryside who live in very modest conditions for years at a time, literally knocking on the door of every single poor person in this country, of this remaining 100 million, where, you know, the deepest pockets of poverty, where, you know, market reforms or, you know, large scale development-led poverty alleviation couldn't really touch. You're talking about communities that might be living off of a cliff, really remote areas that were very, very difficult to reach to. There, for every family, there was a cadre assigned, and for every village, there was a team assigned. So this level of organization and massive amounts of, let's say, grassroots democracy in practice really took place to make this happen. And just wrapping up here is that in this study, we had a privilege to visit Guizhou, which is one of the historically poorest provinces, very ethnically diverse, ecologically rich, and extremely mountainous. And so we went to the mountains and to seek truth from facts, as John really likes to say. And we got to meet party cadre, peasants in the villages, business owners, people who were lifted out of poverty, but most importantly, lifted themselves out of poverty in the process. It was about creating the conditions in which people could actually lift themselves and maintain and ensure that they can be stay out of poverty. And to witness many processes, programs, and how it actually happened was, I think, a huge privilege. And I encourage everyone, when it comes out on the 23rd, which is the historic date of the centenary of the first Congress of the CPC, when it comes out. But it's a real honor, I think, to be able to share some thoughts and learn from John, and to be able to use a lot of what he's learned studying China all these years towards a project that can share more stories from China. So congratulate John on publishing the book and on this year of the centenary of the CPC. And thank you all for organizing this webinar.